Hello and welcome to our second episode of Southeast Ohio Sports Talk. I'm Ben Spicer, sports reporter with the Portsmouth Daily Times, alongside sports editor Kevin Colley. And Kevin, of course, on this episode, we're going to talk about the SOC One teams.
Yes.
That's East, Notre Dame, Northwest, and Green. So we're going to lead things off with East, who just had a sensational season last year. And when you look at some of their kids and their stats, I mean, Braden Haney had 20 sacks. You're kind of questioning them and saying, hey, is this accurate? But then you watch the film, and this kid is sensational. And he was a freshman.
Yeah.
And then they have Kyle Flannery, who had 8 interceptions. Just looking at their schedule, do you think they're going to have any issues in the conference?
I think East and Oak Hill, it'll be a dogfight. They both have football players, and both coaches are as impressed with their teams as they have been. Yes, for the Tartan fans out there, losing Akia Brown is going to be a tough one to replace, obviously, with his breakaway speed, rushing over 1,000 yards 4 years in a row. I wouldn't worry too much. You got Brady Douthat coming in, filling in Drew Lowe's shoes. He's a great game manager, just a tough, gritty football player. And that's how the entire roster is. And I think that will even make East a better football team, because you're not depending so much maybe on the breakaway speed of Akia to get you, you know, the 10, 15, 20 yards that you need to keep moving the football down the field. You're kind of grinding it out. And they got guys like that. You got Ethan Carver, Ethan Gifford. You've got just so many tough and gritty football players. And Haney and Flannery as freshmen putting up the numbers that they did, it's really scary to see what they can do. Then you haven't even talked about the central figure that everybody talks about, and that's Blaine Scott. He missed most of the season last year with injury, and he's coming back. So that's really scary to think about what they can do. I mean, I think I see another 10-win season, you know, 9-10-win season in the cards for East, and I think they'll be hoisting the SOC One title again.
And yeah, East fans, on that schedule, you did see it right. There is Danville on the schedule, and I talked to Coach Gifford about that move, and his thoughts were pretty interesting.
I'm just a competitor, you know. They beat us in the playoffs. It was the only team that beat us last year, so what better way to get back at them than to schedule them in regular season? So, and I'm a type of person, too. I would rather, you know, not predicting a loss. We're expecting to go up there to win, but I'm a type of person to I'd rather lose against a really good team to prepare us for the playoffs than to beat somebody that's we're expected to beat.
Always good to hear from Coach Gifford. So moving on to Notre Dame, they lost a couple big pieces of their offense as well.
Sure
you
did.
Talk about Sam Kayser. He had 30 total touchdowns last year.
Right.
And then Isaiah Johnson with 16 rushing touchdowns. So for the Titans, some guys to watch out for. It looks like Ben Mader is going to be the feature back for
yes.
the Titans this season. What can we expect out of Bob Ashley's group?
They're going to be competitive and fight. Bob is such a tough, gritty coach, and that's what he wants his players to emphasize, that kind of attitude. Go out there and just fight. You know, if you give maximum effort, you know, at the end of the day, he's going to be, you know, satisfied with that. You know, obviously Notre Dame has numbers issues, and that's going to make it tough for any team to, you know, really be at their best. But the thing that you can always count on from Bob Ashley's group is that they're going to fight, they're going to be competitive, and they're going to have guys who grow as the year goes on because of the coaching they're going to receive and because of the work ethic they're going to have when the season ends. So I look for Notre Dame to be a better football team at the end of the season than they were at the beginning. And if they can keep that group together, I really think if you're looking 2 years down the road, I think they could have something really special.
I met with Coach Ashley for Notre Dame's media day. He said it was important for them to get some early success. So you take a look at that schedule. Southern, who they're going to open the season with, went 8-3 last season. That's definitely a tough game for the Titans to open up with. But then you have Millersport at 1-9 last season, Fayetteville at 6-4 last year, and Manchester at 1-9. So definitely some manageable games for the Titans, and they could compete with some teams in the SOC One as well. And you think, as you mentioned, with Ashley's teams, they're always tough and gritty and willing to fight. So moving on to Northwest and their head coach, Doug Montavon. We met with him the other day at their media day, and they've got some position battles going on.
Yeah.
I'll tell you a little bit about that. At quarterback, they've got 3 guys competing. Garrett Rowe, who was the starter for most of the season last year, Timmy Emmons, and Ashton Hall. And then there's even some battles in the backfield. Coach Montavon says some of those guys will play other positions on offense, but the running back position is still open. It looks like several guys are going to be playing running back
right.
for the Mohawks And just looking at their schedule, they've got Southeastern, who went 6-4 last season. Huntington Ross was 3-7. They're from Chillicothe, not Huntington. That confused me at first. Rock Hill went 6-4 last season. So the non-conference schedule could be a bit of a challenge for Northwest. Let's hear Doug Montavon's thoughts on his team this season.
Well, this year we've got a little bit more depth experience than we had last year, and we're hoping to improve upon last year's record with most of the team returning. We're returning 9 offensive starters and 8 defensive starters. Just hoping to improve on last year's record. Having depth and players fighting for spots has really improved this year. Like I said, the experience, we're bringing back mostly everyone, and the character of the team. It's something we worked on in our off-season lifting program, what leadership is, what's expected out of you, how to be a good person. And all of those things are starting to come together a little bit, and it seems like we're getting where we need to be.
Kevin, what will it take for Northwest to be competitive this season? They have some depth this year.
Keeping the team together. That's the most important thing. And it looks like Coach Montavon, the most successful part of the offseason is, you know, keeping the team together, and he's done that. The weight room work has definitely shown. I think, you know, Kyle Wesley is a great leader, and he's going to be a big factor in the tight end and defensive end positions. Obviously, you know, that Wesley family at Northwest with his older brother Hank being in the Navy, it has great genes. I look for a big season from Kyle, and I look for Northwest to be a much improved football team. I think they'll be in the top 4 in the SOC 1. They could even sneak into the top 3 there and wreak some havoc there with, you know, playing Oak Hill. They've given Oak Hill problems. I wouldn't be surprised a bit either if they gave these problems. Northwest has got some guys there, some potential. Their numbers are a lot better than they were last year, and it looks like Coach Montavon's doing a great job with his team. They keep the team together. They could surprise some people.
Yeah, Leslie's leadership, unprecedented for the Mohawks. And another big leader in the conference is Green's Ted Newsom. They went 3-7 last season. 2 of those wins, though, they came at the start of the year, and they play some of the teams that they played last year, of course, in the conference, but they're also going to play Hannon again, and the Bobcats beat Hannon 60-0 last season. They'll also play West Union from Ohio in the non-conference schedule. So Green, obviously, they have low numbers. What can you expect from them this season under Coach Newsom?
Yeah, and Coach Newsom's no stranger to the numbers. The numbers difficulty in 2014, he had similar numbers. He ended up getting some more players out as the years went. He had to deal with some injuries too, and some question marks about whether they were going to finish the season or not with 6 or 7 players getting hurt. He's had to deal with these questions before, but I'll tell you, he does an excellent job of just managing players and finding ways to put them when adversity hits. He's very, very good at knowing how to instill in the kids, you know, how to deal with that adversity. What you're going to get from Green, they're going to fight. I mean, they're prideful of Franklin Furnace, they're prideful of what they represent. They embrace that underdog role. They want to be, you know, underdogs. They take that as a pride thing, and they want to show people that they can compete. Last season, you know, winning 3-4 games, I mean, that shows that they're making some strides. And I thought Coach Newsom did an excellent job last year. Hopefully, we can see that more from Green. I know a lot of people have been rooting for Green as they've kind of made their ascension back up to the days of old, where in 89 and 90 they were in the playoffs and kind of the class of the SOC 1 at one point. Sadly, the last 10, 15 years, you know, it hasn't really been that way, but, you know, Green being competitive makes the entire conference better as a whole.
And Kevin, fortunately for us, high school football season is just right around the corner. We won't have to just be all talk in the future, but it's been great doing this show with you, and I hope you guys have enjoyed it as well. Be sure to check out future episodes down the road. For Kevin Colley, I'm Ben Spicer. Thanks for watching, guys.